Welcome to the Rochester Museum and Science Center Science Storytime. Thanks for joining me today. My name is Allison, and today our story is called The Very Quiet Cricket by Eric Carle. In the front of our book here, we have a special note from the author that gives us a little scientific information about crickets. There are 4,000 different kinds of crickets. Some live underground, others above. Some live in shrubs or trees, and some even live in water. Both male and female crickets can hear, but only the male can make a sound. By rubbing his wings together, he chirps. Some people say that it sounds like a song. The Very Quiet Cricket by Eric Carle. One warm day, from a tiny egg, a little cricket was born. "Welcome," chirped a big cricket, rubbing his wings together. The little cricket wanted to answer, so he rubbed his wings together. But nothing happened, not a sound. "Good morning," whizzed a locust, spinning through the air. The little cricket wanted to answer, so he rubbed his wings together. But nothing happened. Not a sound. "Hello," whispered a praying mantis, scraping its huge front legs together. The little cricket wanted to answer, so he rubbed his wings together. But nothing happened. Not a sound. "Good day," crunched a worm, munching its way out of an apple. The little cricket wanted to answer, so he rubbed his wings together, but nothing happened. Not a sound. "Hi," bubbled a spittle bug, slurping in a sea of froth. The little cricket wanted to answer, so he rubbed his wings together, but nothing happened. Not a sound. "Good afternoon," screeched a cicada, clinging to a branch of a tree. The little cricket wanted to answer, so he rubbed his wings together, but nothing happened. Not a sound. "How are you?" hummed a bumblebee, flying from flower to flower. The little cricket wanted to answer, so he rubbed his wings together, but nothing happened. Not a sound. "Good evening," whirred a dragonfly, gliding above the water. The little cricket wanted to answer, so he rubbed his wings together, but nothing happened, not a sound. "Good night," buzzed the mosquitoes, dancing among the stars. The little cricket wanted to answer, so he rubbed his wings together, but nothing happened, not a sound. A Luna moth sailed quietly through the night, and the cricket enjoyed the stillness. As the Luna moth disappeared silently into the distance, the cricket saw another cricket. She, too, was a very quiet cricket. Then he rubbed his wings together one more time, and this time he chirped the most beautiful sound that she had ever heard. The end. Thanks for joining me today. That was The Very Quiet Cricket, a story by Eric Carle. Stick around and later we'll discover more about crickets and other insects. In our story today, The Very Quiet Cricket, we met a cricket who, in his journey throughout the day, met some of his friends, a butterfly, a moth, a grasshopper, and he wasn't able to say hello. He couldn't make a sound. It wasn't until the very end of our story and just before dark when he met another cricket that he was able to rub his wings together and make noise. Crickets, as you may know, are mostly nocturnal, which means that they rest during the day and they are most active at night. Around here, spring is just starting to warm up, which means on these warmer spring evenings, you might start to hear crickets in the fields, the hills, in your backyard, making these sounds. It's the sounds of cricket music. Crickets are often thought to make their noise by rubbing their legs together, but it's actually when they rub their wings together. Cricket wings have special designs. On the bottom of their wings, they have these rough, ridge-like, almost like teeth. I picture it as kind of like the bottom edge of this comb. The top surface of their wings is designed to be smooth, kind of like a scraper. So when they go to make a sound and they rub their wings together, you hear that classic cricket sound, that chirping. The chirping of the cricket sounds that you hear, that rubbing together of their wings, is called stridulation. This is just a big science word that means they're rubbing two body parts together to make this sound. The sounds that we hear actually serve a practical purpose for the crickets. They're communicating with other crickets. The males that make these sounds are attracting females and sending warning sounds out to the other males in the area. Today, I'm going to share with you two activities. One, a hands-on activity that's going to explore the science of sound, and the other is more like a family field trip you can take into your backyard to do a little experiment about crickets. Okay, so for our first activity I want to share with you guys today, we are making a chirping cricket using some very simple materials. Here you can see I have some plastic cups, yarn or string, I have some paper clips, and a nail or a tack, something you can use to poke a hole in the top of the cup. Adults, make sure you're helping with this part of the project. Tape, I have a Sharpie here, and I have a paper towel that's been folded up and is slightly damp. So what you're gonna wanna do is take a cup, and if you want, you can decorate it however you want. Sometimes we turn these into chickens or cackling witches. Today we're gonna use our imagination and turn them into chirping crickets. So I've got a cup here, grab a marker, you could put googly eyes on it, attach feathers, whatever you wanna do. The first step is take a tack, a push pin, and with an adult's help, you wanna poke a hole right in the bottom of your cup. Again, with an adult's help, make sure you can widen up that hole just a little bit, because what you're gonna wanna do is cut a piece of your yarn. I've cut mine here, maybe about 18 inches. Sometimes it helps to take a piece of scotch tape and wind it right around the end, and then take your loose end and you're gonna put that through the hole. At the other end, you wanna tie a paper clip. Now, the paper clip is not what's gonna make the noise, but it is gonna hold your string onto the cup. So you've got your loose end here, you're just gonna slide it through that hole and pull it through the other side, just like this, and you're almost ready to go. Here we have my finished chirping cricket. Take your paper towel, make sure it's a little bit damp, and you're gonna hold the cup in one hand, and then take your paper towel and pinch it onto the string. And it might take a little bit of practice. And as you pinch it, slide the paper towel with your fingers right down the string. You don't want to go super fast and just do it like this, because you won't really get the chirping sound. But you kind of want to do in short, jerking motions. And while it kind of sounds like a clucking chicken, again, we're using our imagination and turning this into a chirping cricket today. What you're doing here is you're actually making a soundboard. A soundboard is how instruments like pianos or music boxes work. The friction you're applying from your paper towel as you pinch the string is causing the string to vibrate. These vibrations would be silent to our ears without the cup. The cup is actually acting as an amplifier, magnifying the sounds that we hear. Next time you're at the Rochester Museum and Science Center, be sure to check out our exhibit called Sound Bites. In this exhibit, you'll be able to explore more about how we hear and how sound travels in waves, and just more about the science and sound in general. So not only are crickets natural-born fiddlers and chirpers, some people believe that they can actually predict the temperature. As we know, crickets enjoy warmer weather, anything really over 55 degrees Fahrenheit. The warmer it is, the more likely you're going to hear crickets singing outside in your backyard. The relationship between crickets and temperature has been studied in a variety of different cricket species. One of the laws that has come out of this research is called Dolbear's Law. And now while Dolbear's Law studied the snow tree crickets, which don't live here around Rochester, we can go outside in our backyard and take a quick family field trip one of these warm spring evenings to see how accurate the common field crickets are in our backyards in predicting temperature. It's really easy. All you'll need to do is head out into your backyard and bring with you a timer. To figure out Dolbear's Law, here's what you need to do. Set your timer for 14 seconds. Then count the number of chirps you hear in those 14 seconds. To that number, just add 40. According to Dolbear's Law, that's going to give you a pretty accurate prediction of the current temperature. Again, this law was research with crickets that don't live in our area, but it is still a fun way to see how different the common field crickets are compared to the snow tree crickets that Dolbear used. Next time you're headed outside on a warm spring evening, bring the whole family and try your hand at figuring out how accurate the crickets are in your backyard in determining temperature. Thanks so much for joining me for Science Story Time today. I'm Allison with the Rochester Museum and Science Center, and I hope you enjoyed learning a little bit more about the science of sound and the chirping of crickets.